If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order. Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to talk about solar power and my process of building and setting up a test bed. Now, before I get started, because there's going to be a lot of talking, there's going to be several videos, I'm going to explain how those are all going to pan out. But let me start by showing you a little experiment which kind of encapsulates my excitement in terms of solar power and my study in terms of trying to understand which solar panels work best under what circumstances and the spectral response, which is something I need to take into account when building my test bed. So let me just show you a little interesting experiment first. So this is an amorphous solar panel, right? It's a thin film panel. Many years ago, there was a promise that these would be made to be really cheap and it would bring down the cost of solar power radically. But these actually ended up tended to be more expensive, and they weren't as efficient. They were only around 12 to 14% efficient, whereas the later solar panels, in particular this one by SunPower, the actual cells, not the encapsulation, these SunPower modules are in the order of, let's say, 21 to 25%. And that's an incredible difference between these two. So let me also put in perspective. This is a 2-watt solar panel. This is a 3.5-watt solar panel, right? And look at the size difference. But now I want to show you something very interesting. So this puts out 2 watts, this puts out 3.5 watts under full power. But what I want to show you is this solar panel. If I bring it up to the camera, you can see it's got a little blue LED there, right? That's being illuminated. That's to show it's actually operating, right? If I take a lot, let me just get a piece of paper quickly. If I put the piece of paper over the panel, you can see the blue LED goes out. And just remember, blue LEDs take a fair bit more power to illuminate than, let's say, a red LED. So if I pull that away, you can see how quickly that illuminates. Now, as the other solar panel doesn't have a built-in LED, I've got a blue LED here, which I'm going to connect to this. So here we go. Now, this solar panel is illuminating 2 blue LEDs. So I'm not too worried about the fact that it's illuminating 2 blue LEDs, but you can see quite clearly I've got this one connected to the output over here, and it is being illuminated. And I'm just standing in my cabin. I've got reasonably bright ambient light because I'm filming, but nonetheless, it's ambient light, it's not sunlight, and it's able to do this. Now let me get the other panel. So here we go, I've got the other panel. I'll hold it on the edges so that I'm not obscuring the panel. Can you see any blue light coming out of this LED? Holding it in the same way, I'm going to move it towards a bright light I've got over here. This is really a bright filming light. As I place, there we go, now it's illuminated, but this light is really bright. But as soon as I bring it away, it's not operating. Unlike this one with its internal LED, which is working fine. And I find that fascinating. And so during the course of these videos, this is going to be really important, is to understand why this panel is able to do that. It's less powerful indoors versus this one. So let me give you the breakdown of these videos. Right, so again, I'll warn you up front. In these videos, in the first one in particular, there's going to be a lot of talking explaining my learning experience over several years and how I'm trying to pull that together to build this test bed so where I can test solar panels indoors under more consistent conditions. It's been quite a journey to get to this point. So a fair bit of talking. I'm going to go down some rabbit holes, pulling information from all over the place. In the second video, I'm specifically going to focus on amorphous or thin film solar panels and how they potentially perform better under low light conditions, like indoors or low light outdoors, versus a traditional monocrystalline or polycrystalline solar panel? That's been something that's always bugged me over the years, is that statement of how they perform better, but why? And there are several reasons which I've put together, some that I've kind of anecdotally researched and measurements that I've made myself, and then white papers I've read, which kind of back up my own experience. And even yesterday and today, I did some experiments outside and some measurements, and they again are going to be quite interesting. Now, I also just want to warn you that I'm not a professional in solar power. I'm just intrigued by it. Even though I'm gleaning experience and test results from a lot of what I do, it doesn't mean it's always necessarily correct, right? I'm having to make a few assumptions, and that can be dangerous. I'll explain the facts behind those assumptions, but often I'm having to do this because there's not a lot of information out there on potentially some of the topics I'm going to talk about or cover right now. So that'll be the second video. Why does that work better under low light potentially versus a normal solar panel? And then in part three, we'll actually build my test bed. I'm looking at a crazy mess on my bench over here because when you're experimenting and changing things in and out, things get a bit messy. I've gone to a bigger test bed. This used to be, you'll remember this mirror that I built. It's about, if I remember, 1 foot by 1 foot. The other one is 2 foot by 2 foot. So I've got a bigger test area. It allows me bigger solar panels, more lighting. And I'll explain the testing and the challenges when we actually put that together. I've already got calibration data from outside. So in part three, I'm hoping to put that all together, calibrate it, and see if I can get close to measuring various different types of solar panels reasonably correctly. Right. So let's get stuck in with the kind of theory and the challenge of trying to put that together. If you've been on my channel long enough, you'll know that I did a video several years ago, and I'm staring at the grow light, the Mars grow light, and I'll do an insert over here. I wanted to see if you could power a solar panel indoors and reach the same power output as you could outdoors in the sun. That was a challenge for me. And after playing around with a whole lot of grow lights and what have you, I discovered that you could. This is a nice big grow light with some caveats, right? And I certainly, there were a lot of things I didn't quite realize at that point in time, which I've learned along the way. One of those is the kind of spectrum that those grow lights put out. For one, because LED, it's very peaky in certain wavelengths of light, and it's certainly not a true representation of the sun. So let's cover that off first, is trying to get a test bed which is similar to a commercial test bed, right? Now, the one thing is that there are certain standards that solar simulators have to adhere to in terms of the amount of spectrum that they test solar panels under, and the repeatability of those tests and the consistency of the light across the test bed area. And those are fairly stringent. But even though they've got all these parameters they have to work to, and they class the different solar testers in terms of class A, B, C, they still don't truly represent the sunlight outside. And it is almost impossible to do that because the sunlight falling to the earth is different all over the place, and it changes all the time. I'll talk about this when we get to my testing outdoors. And that's the reason I want a test bed, because things are changing all the time. The light intensity changes from in different parts of the day because of clouds or where the position of the sun. The sun comes through different amounts of atmosphere. Over the equator, it's going through less atmosphere, and in Europe or the southern hemispheres, it's going through more atmosphere. And that is taken into account in the testing. Now, when I say take into account, they assume an air mass. You'll see this thing, 1.5 AM air mass. They assume and part of the Earth, Europe in particular, is what they model their testing on, because that is the largest market, or has been the largest market, for solar panels. So they market the testing and the results based on roughly the conditions in Europe. Now, certainly the air mass conditions. But the spectrum changes throughout the day. I'm going to show you some very interesting inserts in a moment about that. It changes during the day, and it changes depending on subtly where you're pointing, towards the sun, 90 degrees away from the sun, 180 degrees from the sun, in the morning before the sun has come up, sunrise, and you can see it, and it's sunset. And all of these have a huge effect on solar panel performance. So you cannot simulate that. So ultimately what I'm trying to do, and realize, rather than trying to exactly simulate the sun, I'm trying to get a good approximation of the sun for the results that I get outside here in North Carolina. So let's first go over some less esoteric details in terms of testing, standard testing versus, I think it's PV USA, PTC, and then NOCT. So NOCT is a normal operational cell temperature, I think. We're going to look at that, because if I'm going to kind of set up any test bed, I want to have some certain parameters which I work to, even if I don't adhere to everything. What I want to do is ultimately not exactly try and replicate those standards, but at least have consistent testing that I can repeat. So if I've got two different solar panels, and here in particular I'm talking about, let's say, two different cell technologies, like a monocrystalline, polycrystalline versus an amorphous one, which responds to different parts of the spectrum, is that they yield virtually the same results outside as they do under their lights. So before I show you those test parameters, let me just talk about that, what happened in that first testing under my sunlight simulator when I was using the grow light. So first off, this sunlight simulator, I had to be about heavens, an inch or two above the panel, to produce the same power output as outdoors with a normal solar panel. I'm talking a monocrystalline or a polycrystalline. What I discovered, which started this journey, was that when I put my amorphous panel under that, that this panel at max produces about 4.5 to 4.6 watts. It's a 5-watt panel, but it only produces about 4.6 watts under ideal conditions outside in normal daylight, when you've got 1,000 watts per square meter. So that's the irradiance measurement coming down to Earth. Stuck under that light, it achieved 9.6 watts in a short instant before it started heating up, and that was the issue. With only 2 inches, panels heat up very quickly and suddenly the power drops off. But 9.6 watts, and consistently it was doing about 8.5 or 8.6. And that's incredible. And why is that? It's because of the spectral response of this panel versus other panels. So before we talk about that in particular, let's just talk about testing. I've done a separate video on this, so I'm not going to go too much into it. I'm just going to kind of give some of the highlights. And again, if you can't see this, I'll do a little insert. It's just a quick chart to show you that there are various test standards. And sometimes when you go and read these, you can sometimes the parameters differ. I've certainly, with one of these, I've gone and read two different places and they're slightly different. But STC, this is probably the most common one you see on your solar panel, standard test conditions. And what they do is they have a test bed. They simulate the power that you'd get under an air mass of 1.5, which is, again, let's say somewhere in Europe. The solar radiation they're simulating is 1,000 watts per square meter. Now, we're going to come back to that, because generally speaking, depending where you are on the planet and the time of year, you're not going to get 1,000 watts per square meter. But this is just trying to show you a kind of practical theoretical maximum that your panel will do under normal, well, I won't call them normal conditions, I call it standard. and then a module temperature of 25 degrees Celsius. So those are the parameters, and what they normally do is they just have a light which flashes on. The panel is held at a temperature of 25 degrees Celsius. You've got a light intensity which is doing an equivalent of 1,000 watts per square meter for an air mass of 1.5. Now that isn't real world. You are really going to see the power output from your solar panel that these test results show. You are generally only going to see these when you have a bright, clear day, generally in winter. So I found this in South Africa and here in the USA. On a clear, not necessarily clear day, sometimes hazy days, when you've got that hazy cloud in the sky, it creates a light dispersion across the sky, and that can actually work better than a clear pinpoint of sun sometimes. So you, with the panel being cooled and good light dispersion or a good bright clear day, you can see in excess of the panel rating. I've seen 110-120% of the power output briefly from a solar panel when the conditions are really cold and you've got a clear sky. I imagine, like, if you went to the Arctic or something like that and you've got sub-zero temperatures, you potentially would see that as well, as long as you haven't got frost or snow on the panels. Then we get something, and these parameters, I don't know whether it was done for California, but I know California tended to use it, it was PVUSA, PTC. These are more real world. They're saying air mass 1.5, solar radiation 1,000 watts per square meter, but an air temperature, not a panel temperature, an air temperature of 20 degrees Celsius. So why do they say that? Different types of solar panels, they reach different operating temperatures. And I'm going to show you from some test results and some panels how the backing of a solar panel can affect that. So sometimes you'll see a solar panel has a white backing and you can actually see it through the cells. So the panel looks predominantly white and you've either got the dark silicon or bluish silicon on the solar panel versus these black solar panels. And I chuckle because sometimes you'll see on Amazon, and in recent years I've seen it, like, this is the black solar panel, like it's a fashionable thing, it looks nicer than these older white panels. But guess what? Those black panels heat up more than a white panel and their power drops off. So it's crazy to have these black solar panels. But here in these tests, they're saying an ambient temperature of 20 degrees Celsius, and then basically you're letting the panel, whatever the panel, its own normal operating temperature is at ambient of 20, that's what you take. Then you've got what they call, I've seen knocked testing or test results, so normal operating cell temperature, and this is where they get, to me, this is the most real world. And it is something that I'm going to work to, and I'll explain why in a moment. So there again, air mass 1.5, solar radiation of 800 watts per square meter, right, as opposed to 1,000. And then again, an air temperature of 20 degrees, so not a panel temperature, although I have seen written into this somewhere in another place I read about this test, these test parameters. It noted a panel temperature of 45 degrees Celsius. So there I take issue, because that's a conflict. If you have an ambient air temperature of 20 degrees Celsius, it doesn't mean that your panel can sit at 45, because more often than not, it's gonna be sitting above 50 degrees in 20 degrees Celsius. I've seen this many times, yesterday and the day before in my testing. I had an ambient temperature of 20 to 21 degrees Celsius. It's cool, it's autumn now here in the States. And the panels were sitting at 50 to 60 degrees Celsius in terms of their temperature. The reason I'm going to be adopting something closer to this is, for one, I spent the last three weeks holding my reference cell. Let me pick that up for you. I have this reference cell which is used to measure the irradiance from the sun. I'm very fortunate in one of the devices I was given for review. The most valuable thing to me that came out of this big fancy meter for testing solar panels was this device. I've recently just ordered some more of these off eBay. I saw like a batch of these going for a ridiculously cheap price. These normally go for $1,000 to $3,000, just a calibrated test cell. And what this does, this one has a monocrystalline and a polycrystalline cell in it. You connect a meter, which I've got over there, nothing fancy. The meter reads the output from that and translates that to watts per square meter. And that's how I can judge whether I've got the right illuminance or flux coming from the sun, the right brightness, if you will, so I can measure, do consistent measurements on the solar panels. And these are critically temperature compensated. So if the power on these were to drop off and the reading dropped off, that wouldn't be helpful. You need a consistent reading which isn't affected by temperature. And that's what's special about this. It's temperature compensated and calibrated to give you a good reading. And in the last 3 weeks when I've been going outside, the maximum level that I've seen was about 700 to 750 watts per square meter. And it just shows you that you really need good conditions or to be living in a certain part of the world. Let's say if you're on the equator, to see average levels at 1,000 or above. And at the equator, it's generally going to be hotter. So even though you've got those, you might have more sunlight, your panels will potentially be affected by heat more there than in once you stray away from the equator. So more realistic, to get more realistic results, I'm going to work on something between 800 and 850 because those were the figures that I was getting outside yesterday. So I've got results, got several panels, and that's what I'm going to use. The other good reason for me to use something like 800 rather than trying to step up to 1,000 watts per square meter is the lights. So let's talk about the lights which I'm going to be using on my test bed. I had initially hoped that I'd be trying to recreate something like the grow light, this Mars grow light, where you've got a full array right across your test area. So you get a nice even spread of light because you've got LEDs going right down onto your test area. The problem with those lights is that it didn't properly represent the spectrum. Newer grow lights are getting closer. I use a grow light as one of my lights in this area. I bounce it off the ceiling. And the reason I use it is actually not for filming. It's almost like, you know, those sad lights, which kind of, if you don't get enough sunlight, your vitamin D levels go down. This light really gives me a good feeling. It's a nice representation almost of the sun. It's not, of course, the sun, but it certainly, I'd almost say, elevates my mood. It really is a nice light source. Now, so I've been struggling over several years and experimenting with various LED setups to try and get LEDs to do the visible part of the spectrum, the infrared part of the spectrum, and the UV part of the spectrum. And the one thing I've been struggling with is that to try and get enough power output from even some really powerful LEDs compared to the visible part of the spectrum, I've really struggled. And also, you're looking at a very pinpoint part of light. I'd need many of these LEDs lined up in an array to get a more uniform spread of light. And so what I've had to go to basically is the light that I showed not too long ago is the 500 watt LED from UG Lights. So that LED alone is just absolutely amazing in terms of allowing me to power a solar panel without any other light. So no UV, no infrared, just that visible part of the spectrum. I can power a solar panel to what it will produce outside in proper sunlight conditions, and it is a foot away from the solar panel, which is incredible. So that is putting out more than one sun. It is brighter than the sun in the visible part of the spectrum, which is, again, it's absolutely incredible to think you can do that. Now, it kicks out a fair bit of heat, but fortunately, being a foot away, it's far less of a problem when I'm only a few inches away. So I have the visible part of the spectrum. And so again, one could argue, well, heavens, if I can put the power output of a solar panel just for that one light, why not just use that? Why? Because if I calibrate that to work with, and I'll show you, a monocrystalline and a polycrystalline panel, and the reason I'm pulling these up is I want to show you the black panel versus the one with white backing. I'll power these to what they would do outside, but if I put this panel underneath it, this will put out double its rated power because it is more sensitive to that part of the spectrum. So on the screen now, what I'm going to put up is a diagram that comes from a white paper that actually talks about amorphous or thin film solar panels. And on there, it'll show you, one of the lines will show you the spectral output and the various intensities at the different parts of the spectrum of the sun. And then it's got a couple of other graphs, one to show a normal mono or polycrystalline solar panels, and then the other one which represents thin film or amorphous silicon solar panels. And the interesting thing there you'll see is that the amorphous solar panels are certainly more concentrated to the visible part of the spectrum, and this explains why a bright LED will provide far more power for these than another solar panel. Because those other solar panels, if you look at that graph, they have got a far broader range of light that they are looking at. They are looking at still roughly from around 300 to 350 nanometers all the way up to 1,300 and beyond into a top part of the infrared range. It's a far broader part of the light spectrum than this panel. But this panel is particularly sensitive around the blues and the UV. And in fact, the UV, although they both drop off at the UV, the amorphous panels, and I don't want to generalize, I'll come back to that, but the amorphous panels are more sensitive to the UVs, the blues going just towards the green part of the light spectrum. Now, the reason I don't want to generalize, it depends on what elements they've been doped with. There's a PN junction, I've got another video which goes into how solar panels work, but in the PN junction, those are doped, and depending on what element they've doped with will dictate what part of the spectrum the technology or the solar panel is more sensitive to. And these, I've seen thin panels which from my little bit of testing seem to be actually more sensitive to the reds and the infrareds. And that's why it can be misleading when you think, this is a thin film panel, it's going to perform well indoors. And that's why I've got a whole bunch of these little flashlights or LEDs on my bench. They've all got calibrated LEDs at different parts of the spectrum. I've been calibrating them with a quantum flux meter, which we'll talk about in another video. But I'm doing this experiment to see if I can create a meter or a measurement tool to give me a rough idea of what part of the spectrum a panel is sensitive to. Because I know that just by taking a panel out of my collection, which looks like a thin film panel, doesn't mean it's necessarily focused on the visual and the, let's say, the UV part of the spectrum. And so coming back to that little experiment that I did when I started off, now you may have a little bit of insight when you understand what part of the spectrum that thin film, this 2-watt panel, looks at compared to the sun power panel. The sun power panel is more sensitive to and gains more of its power from the red to infrared part of the spectrum, whereas this panel gets most of its power from the visible part, kind of where the greens, the blues going down into the UV part of the spectrum. And that's why this works so well indoors under natural light, where there's a very little infrared, say, versus this other panel. And so why is that interesting? Well, it's amazing to think that you could potentially power some devices indoors. And things like, think about calculators on your desk or your solar powered watches. They are going to be using this technology because they can actually harvest a fair amount of power indoors from visible light because of the cell technology which is being used. Now, there's something more that does come into that. And now we're going to, when we move into part two, I'm going to start talking about why in particular these panels, besides their makeup, why they perhaps work better under low light conditions and even shading. We'll have a closer look at these. But before we go there, so the one thing about my test bed, which is different now, is I'm going to have this 500 watt LED, and I'm augmenting with normal incandescent infrared lights, because compared to an LED giving off infrared, you get far greater intensity of light from an incandescent light, also a far broader spread. If you get an infrared LED, it's going to be very peaky. It's going to peak very close to a very narrow band of light compared to an infrared light or even a normal incandescent globe. A halogen light, it gives off a nice broad swath of infrared, which is what I need for my testing. The UV light, I'm using a combination of an LED light, but it's peaky. I then also have some CFL globes, and as opposed to like a very focused point source, like when I was experimenting with LEDs, they're going to throw the light, and the mirrors around the side are going to scatter the light. So although I am going to have point sources, it is going to be scattered. How uniform that's going to be is questionable, and that's going to be one of the shortcomings perhaps of my test bed, is the uniformity of all the light. But I'm hoping to get this balance whereby when I put the two different solar panel technologies under my setup, they'll give roughly the same readings as I get outside. But let's get into part two.